This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today we are going back to the fields of Wilshire, and we have been there many times over the years, and some of you are going to say, why should we do that? Well, things are changing rapidly. The U.S. government is in the process of releasing a lot of video, and it will be apparently released over the course of the summer, much more, of UFOs that it has taken. We have no idea why this is being done now or what it means, and I'm not sure anybody really does, including the people doing it. However, it means that these little lights in the sky are something real. They're not ours. The government has admitted that. And there is plenty of video of them in the crop formations and making crop formations. And we're going to talk to two experts today. Darcy Weir is a filmmaker. He has made a new film called Crop Circle Realities. And he is partnered with Gary King, a crop circle researcher of 20 years, who is also an attorney and has had the experience of walking into over 900 crop formations. Now, there are two reasons that this whole subject has sort of been dropped by the public. The first reason is denial from the very beginning by the government. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes. The second reason is nobody understands the crop formations. What are they for? Yeah, they're beautiful, but what do they say to us? We're going to explore some of that today. And we're going to go down some new paths, and we're going to make some new discoveries. And so welcome Darcy Weir and Gary King to Dreamland. Thank you very much for spending some time with us.
Thank you, Whitley.
Yeah, okay. Now, I think I'd like to start and just speak up as we go along, as you wish. Very early on with the mowing devil, because I think the most important thing we can do here is explore what this may mean and how it relates to human beings, because otherwise it's not important to us. It's simply an annoyance to some farmers who lose their crops and have their fields disfigured. Now, I want to go back to the mowing devil. Can you tell us about the two things that happened? The argument between the farmers before it appeared, and then the appearance of this crop formation in, I believe, the 17th century. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If whichever of you would like to talk to this, please do.
I can touch on that at first. I guess the mowing devil showed up. You know, we have copper plates of it from the 1600s. So 1678 is when this article was published.
Excuse me.
Yeah, that's okay. In the Wiltshire area, actually, of the UK, two farmers were said to have had a serious disagreement over pay. It was a wealthier farmer approaching a poor farmer in this area, asked the poor farmer to mow his crops. You know, I don't want to break my back doing it. You're a young man. You do it. So their argument ended with the younger farmer saying, sorry, that pay is just far too low for me, and I'm going to go my own way. But then the poor farmer had a change of heart. He realized that he may not get hired for future jobs if he's going to, you know, nickel and dime over pay. So he went back to the wealthy farmer, and it said that the wealthy farmer was so upset by their argument, he just said, no, I'm not hiring you. The devil shall mow. The devil shall mow my crops rather than you. Well, turns out that night that there was what we do actually see commonly in this phenomenon, there was some sort of paranormal things going on over top of the crop. People reported in the article, it's expanded, that there was balls of fire seen over top of the cropland in this area. And when the wealthy farmer awoke the next day, he saw a large circular formation. All of his crop was laid down. And there's a pretty famous illustration that's included with this copper plate article from 1678 that shows what looks like the devil mowing very neatly this circular formation in the crop. And so one might ask, well, what's that have to do with crop circles? Well, crop circles come in every shape and size, and people can equate them to being agroglyphs or glyphs of some kind that have shown up over the years in this UK area, in the Wiltshire area. And this is the earliest recorded sort of strange event that happened involving crop circles showing up. And it was probably a simple design back then. But as we have progressed, as we have evolved as a human species technologically and consciously, I think what we've seen is the crop circle formation phenomenon escalate. We've seen incredibly intricate designs that have come throughout the years. And this was just the starting point that we can find in our history of recording. But Gary will tell you, that we've even had a deep understanding of geometry and megalithic sites that have to do with the same geometry, the same symmetry, beauty, and mathematics that we can find at these anomalous megalithic sites in the UK. It seems to mirror these extremely beautiful crop formations that we've been receiving every year since.
Well, Gary, that seems like an ideal time to ask you just what do you think of this? Because you have obviously, after all of this work, come to some kind of a conclusion about why this is important to human beings.
My conclusions are that this is like a cosmic therapy lesson for humanity. If you go and visit a therapist, what they need to do is put your cards on the table. You cannot make informed decisions about changing your life or going forward in a different direction to the one you've been going forward in, unless you can properly assess where you've come from, what led you to make decisions about various things along the way, so that you can have all your cards on the table, so that when you can see clearly what's led you to where you are now, then you can make informed decisions about going in a different direction in the future. And so there are five categories of crop circles. There's the geometry, there's the religious and philosophical symbols, there's the animals and the insects, there's the astronomical symbols showing us various planets and how they relate to us in the solar system on a particular day. And then there's a completely abstract category. Those are the five main categories. And geometry being the predominant one, geometry is the pursuit of truth. This is what Plato called various things ever truths. So for example, a circle inside a triangle with a circle on the outside of the triangle makes each of those circles have an exact 2-to-1 ratio. And that's the same as an octave in music. If you hear, when we perceive an octave in music, it's something that bypasses the intellect. We just recognize an octave, an E note at one pitch and an E note at another. And so Plato said that those things are ever truths and we can use them as anchors in the world to pursue truth. And this is why they were so obsessed with creating squared circles, discovering Fibonacci sequences and the golden ratio within nature. So what that exploration of geometry philosophically and cosmologically was pursued by the Greeks to try and find out if the universe that we live in, if the planet that we live on is a part of an intelligent design, and the way it unfolds and the evidence that they come up with seems to suggest that the chances of life being here, the chances of us being here, are extremely remote, except for this fine balance of parameters that we find in the universe. And some fantastic work has been done showing whole number ratios between the mean orbits of the planets in our solar system, the relative sizes of the planets. And a lot of this research is coming out from what we've learned from crop circles. The context of the conversation is also Wiltshire and farming. That's where we've got Stonehenge, where we find the same implicit geometry, a squared circle laid in there by our ancestors. Also, it's where farming began in England. And that created a surplus of grain once we got good at it, which led to wealth, which led to the British Empire, which gives us reasons to look at where we are now as a result of the activities of the British Empire. Because farming began there, because it represented a point where we transitioned from hunter-gatherers to human farmers, it represents a very significant place in our history. And so with the religious and philosophical symbols and the geometry, it's like we're being shown a reminder of, do you remember these are the explorations that you've made to try and understand the cosmos, to try and understand your place in the cosmos, whether it's the yin-yang symbol or the tree of life or the cross of Christ or the geometrical explanations which show us that the solar system isn't randomly ordered, but it's tuned like a guitar. So I think they're laying all these things out for us.
Now, one of the things that you mentioned, megalithic sites, and the megalithic world was very different from this world. We talk about this a lot on Dreamland. The fact that there are many megalithic sites that we could not build now and that we do not understand at all. We don't really understand Stonehenge. We don't understand, certainly, Göbekli Tepe. We couldn't build the pyramids. We couldn't build Sacsayhuaman in Peru. We couldn't build Nan Madol in the Carolinas. There are a lot of things out there that we can't do. Now, let me propose something, just as an idea. Someone is trying to reconnect us with reality because we have lost that. And this is why we can't build in those ways. We can't build the platform at Baalbek. It wasn't built by Roman engineers. That's wrong. We can't do these things. Guys, are these crop formations terribly, terribly important? And I think they are, because someone has a message here. Find what, recover what you have lost.
Yes, I couldn't agree with you more, Whitley.
I agree.
Yeah. It seems to me that the people who built these monuments did so for a very unifying reason, and they did it cooperatively, not with some guy on a horse cracking a whip. And that harks back to a point in our civilization when we worked together and we recognized the unity of all things. We didn't go about it thinking that the planet is just a dead, inanimate object that we can exploit. So I really believe that's what they're trying to do, yes.
I agree. And I think to Gary's point, just the reflection of, you know, the messages that are in the crops, you know, saying we're here, you know, you're not alone. That's one other major message. Somebody who's leaving these messages is constantly reminding us that there's an intelligence behind these intricate and complex formations that are showing up that's super advanced. Because, you know, if you believe that some of these extremely advanced formations have shown up in less than an hour or less than 3 hours in the cover of night with no men to account for, you know, working in the field below with headlamps on their heads and, you know, not using any sophisticated geolocation technology to craft these extremely intricate and perfect glyphs that can only be seen from the sky, then you have to understand that there's an intelligence behind these messages. And, you know, Gary has walked into some of these formations and has seen that they are, you know, many different types of crops. Canola, which is, you know, the stems of these canola plants are as thick as celery and, you know, covered with beautiful yellow flowers. The plants are not destroyed. You know, if it was a man with a rope and a wood board crushing down, like Doug Bauer and Dave Chorley claimed they had done to create all the crop circles, you know, previous to 1990, well, you would see the damage in the stalks. The plants would never be able to grow again. The flowers would be tossed everywhere. And, you know, you just don't see that in many of these intricate 3D geometric shapes that are created in under 3 hours in the cover of night, and no real humans to come forward and say accurately how they made them so perfect and symmetrical from above on a hill. You know, mind you, some of these show up on a hill, not just a flat terrain.
We're talking to Darcy Weir and Gary King about their new documentary, Crop Circle Realities. Free Dreamlanders, this is your moment to decide. I'm sick and tired of watching the same few commercials every week. And go ahead and subscribe and enjoy the magic of Dreamland without the commercials and with the whole show, too. We'll be right back. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
Not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
previously, Garrett Darcy, you briefly mentioned the infamous Doug and Dave. When crop formations first started to hit the news, they were really all over the news, and I will never forget the delighted voices on National Public Radio as they said, the mystery is solved. And I thought to myself at the time, there's something dark here. There's evil abroad. This is an evil act. Someone is doing something. And I want you to expand on this if you know anything about it. These two men were apparently somehow connected with the intelligence community.
Yeah, Andy Thomas.
Go ahead and talk about it, Kerry.
Andy Thomas did some research, and Freddie Silver published it in his book, that they tracked down the press agency that released the story to the Today newspaper, because it was only, first came out and was published by a newspaper called Today, which doesn't exist anymore. But it had at the footnote, MBF Services. And it turns out, to cut a long story short, that the MBF Services was a press agency associated with releasing stories in Northern Ireland on behalf of the British government. So it seems like they used one of their kind of own, either it's an agency that they set up from the beginning or it's an agency that they had an association with that they used to release stories that were biased, obviously, towards the British government with regards to conflicts in Ireland. And they used that agency to release this story about Doug and Dave, which kind of gives us a clue straight away that this was a government-instigated disinformation campaign to pull the wool over everybody's eyes and tell them there's nothing to see here.
Well, this gets to the years-long effort on, for example, the part of the United States Air Force to deny UFO realities. And this is all coming apart at the seams now.
Yeah.
They can't deny them anymore. And they can't deny this anymore. But why did they do it? I think, and I've said, just hold on a second, and I've said this many times, and I keep saying it, they're going to throw people like me under the bus, the media
100%.
Will, and the, and probably people like you too. They'll do anything they can to retain control over this and not let the ordinary people who it's for and who it belongs to have any control whatsoever over it. I know that they will attempt that. But why? What's going on? Do you have any idea why this awful, dark, denying presence is here when this is so beautiful?
I know. I would just add, the story of before Gary's going to go into the particulars about Doug and Dave, when they showed up in time, and things about them that seem very suspect. But I'll say just a little funny thing here. We've heard of stories of men in black,
Yes.
And we've also heard of disinformation agents like Richard Doty, very powerful disinformation agent that worked for the U.S. Air Force and has infiltrated the UFO communities and become a bit of a, storyteller to veer people a certain way from the absolute truths that are out there. But, Doug and Dave Chorley, they really seem to be, I coined in another show we did earlier, men in slacks, because these guys just came out of nowhere and they just claimed responsibility. And as the media does, they cherry picked that one story and they said, mystery solved. Let's move on. Watch sports. Watch celebrity. Forget about anything complex to challenge your daily lives. Now,
but
if you look
at... Let me just interrupt you here just for a second.
Sure.
The media message was that, but there's another message behind it. The message behind it is much darker. It is stay asleep to a dying world and stay asleep to the precious reality of your own soul.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, if you look at, you can Google this crop glyph really easily. If you look up the Arecibo reply is what people call it from 2001.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you about that. So go ahead and talk about it. This is such fun, folks. I'm loving it.
This is like one of the most compassionate messages that, you know, we've ever gotten in the, you know, the whole history of crop circle formations. Carl Sagan in 1974 created and sent out through the Arecibo Space Telescope. It's a massive radio telescope that's located in Puerto Rico. He created a 10-point message that is an identity message. It says who mankind is. This is being sent out into the cosmos in 1974 to our neighbors. It's saying, you know, this is our bodily form. This is the planet we live on around our sun. This is, you know, our DNA. This is the radio wave telescope that we used, the bottom point in that message out of 10 to prove how we use our technology to send this message. And in 2000, the year 2000, in this area called Chilbolton, Chilbolton. Almost failed the spelling bee there. So the Chilbolton crop formation area is pretty famous. And right at that crop field is a massive radio telescope. Interesting. Well, in 2000, we got this very intricate design. People can Google this. It shows a massive sphere in the middle with another sphere, and then connected to it are another two spheres on the side that are a little bit smaller. And then emanating out of those spheres are hundreds of super complex and symmetrical little circles, looking like they are almost a wave of system, some kind of system emanating. We didn't understand what that was. And then in 2001, the exact same location, we got a face, and adjacent to that face, you know, this looks like a 3D printed face. And Gary has said before, it almost looks like those devices we had back in the 90s where you would put your hand into this metal pin system and it would replicate your hand on the other side perfectly, right? Adjacent to that face was a 10-point reply to the Arecibo message. And this showed their bodily form, which was a little bit different. It showed their DNA structure that has silicon, which is added to theirs. We don't have that. It showed It showed their planetary system where they live, showed their planet, and it had three moons, which they've colonized. And it also showed the exact same diagram of that beautiful glyph we saw the year before, which was their microwave telescope system that they used to send out this signal in reply to ours. But this is a massive rectangle adjacent to a face rectangle. And this is saying quite literally to the population of the planet, hey guys, we're here too. You're not alone. We see you. And I think with all of these incredibly geometric shapes that we're getting that are a universal language of math and geometry, as Gary says, geometry is number in space, which is a truth. It will never change. And it's universal across the cosmos for sure. In all these other geometric shape, even solar systems that have shown up, you know, diagrams of our solar system on that day, you know, if Doug and Dave were able to create something so geometrically perfect of the alignment of our solar system on that given day that it showed up, that's just incredible. They would have to patent that technology and show everybody how to do it, but they never did. They passed away, and BBC released another news article last year when crop formations are still showing up. They release an article saying, Doug and Dave, the men who invented crop circles, have now both passed away, with the last one dying this year. And now here's his son to play the guitar in a formation. And it just completely ignores the fact that we're getting these messages that are compassionate. They seem to be showing a reflection of ourselves as humanity. They seem to prove that somebody is watching us, that somebody cares about our future. And they have seen our past. They want to see us succeed as a race in the future.
You know, you mentioned Richard Doty. And way back when we were just sort of getting our feet wet in this, Anne, he came up one way or another. And my wife Anne had a, I don't know if she was a psychic. I don't know exactly what Anne was and is, frankly. She was a wonderful woman, I will say that, and a marvelous wife. But apparently she's a lot more than that. And but during her lifetime, these other aspects were sort of beneath the surface. But when that name came up, she said, "No, stay away, Whitley." She said, "There's something bad there. You don't want to get infected." And every time the intelligence community brushed past me, as it has many times over the years, she would say, "Stay away, Whitley. They're infected. They're all infected, even the ones you love who have been friends for years. Stay away." And when this word infected, it when you talk about what the BBC did, these are people who are innocent of the evil they are doing. But somebody somewhere is infected. Somebody made those editors decide to do that, even though Doug and Dave have been dead, and the formations continue on. And now, of course, they don't report on them anymore. They've gone silent. And again, there is something out there and in here, that wants us to fail. And you guys don't. Okay, Gary, let's go now to Chil Bolton. And you know, I would like to concentrate, if you will, a little bit on that face and the way that it was made. And we'll be talking about the Crabwood Formation in a few minutes as well. Tell us a little bit about that Chil Bolton face, and that was one of the most incredible things I've ever seen. No one can do that.
They used a technique which is used in newspaper print, where you use circles of very different sizes to create an image. It was It was invented, I think, in the 1920s by a man called Eugene Ives. He's the guy that invented this system of newspaper print being in these circles. So when you look closer to the newspaper print, you can see it. Same technique was used to represent this face, which appeared to be pushing through the ground and outwards into the crop, like one of those, as Darcy mentioned, one of those pin cushion things that you pushed your hand or your face into, which gives a suggestion that the enigmatic character who created this crop circle isn't coming from above, but it's coming from below.
Well, that doesn't surprise me.
Right.
Used to come from below at our cabin.
Right.
They came up from the ground.
Yeah. We went back and did a night watching on 888 the year after 2007, and we filmed in infrared a ball of light coming out of the ground and then moving off, rather than coming from above and down. So I think there's something in that we probably have to pay attention to. And then, of course, you had this wonderful reply to the message that we sent in 1974, which would be the perfect reply to the message we sent. They answered it perfectly.
Well, they wouldn't have certainly replied with radio, because I don't think there is such a thing as a radio signal that would be respected as actually real. I had Ivy Loeb on the show, the Harvard astronomer. In fact, he was the head of the Department of Astronomy at Harvard for a long time, who is advocating that Oumuamua, the interstellar object that went through the solar system a couple of years ago may have been an alien probe. And he talks about the never aliens contingent in the scientific community.
Absolutely.
And I said, well, I know scientists who not only are not in that contingent, but also have encountered aliens, and they've been on my show. And so, not the aliens, the scientists. But anyway, he said, it's all the old guys. It's the old guys.
Yeah.
I'm an old guy, and I'm not never an aliens person. Okay.
I have a bit of an explanation for that.
Wait a minute. We've gone past our time. I'm having such a great time. I forgot about the break. Folks, don't you wish that I was having such a great, great time that I would forget the break? And I am actually not going to do the break because I don't want to interrupt this even for a second. So please subscribe to Dreamland and buy my darn books. Go on. No one's buying the Jesus book, Jesus, A New Vision. This is a book, and I don't say this very often, but if you want to know what the visitors know about Jesus, read Jesus, A New Vision. It doesn't mention them at any time in it, but in fact, it comes out of my work with them and with Anne. So it's a wonderful book. Go on Amazon and get it. All right, let's keep going. That's
all right.
The break. The break's done.
I'll quickly say, before Gary takes over here, I will say that, your astute interaction with the academics on this subject, covering up the fact that we're being interacted with, ET visitation and communications. If you look at Seth Shostak, who runs SETI, right? The Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. Every year that they get some kind of bloop or communication through their radio telescopes that are constantly, apparently, supposed to be searching for signs of intelligent extraterrestrial life, they say, oh, it's nothing. It's a quasar that exploded, or it's a, some kind of distant sun that went supernova, yada, yada, yada. If you look at the Chilbolton formation, this is the perfect circumvention of going around that media and information filter. Instead of them sending a signal back to our telescope, which they probably did a little bit quicker than we think after 1974, but that never made headlines. They think to themselves, let's send them a different signal. Let's put down a formation. It'll be reported about in the news. It'll, be photographed and spread across their internet system, and people will know we sent a message, so we don't have to go through SETI. I think that's possibly what their thinking was on that.
That could be the whole crop circle program. It could be. Maybe they were communicating and we don't know it because it was kept secret or denied. And they went to the fields because the fields can't be denied. People are going to see it. Do you
suppose that's right.
The whole thing starts with that?
Yeah. And people always say to me when we're doing these interviews, they say, well, look, why would we believe that crop circles or these agroglyphs are real? When aliens, if they are out there and they're so technologically advanced, they should just land on the White House lawn or, land in the middle of the field and everybody can travel out to the countryside to see them. Why would they leave these glyphs? And I say to them every time, we have a history of being a violent race. And if you believe that the intelligence agencies have been covering up this secret since at least 1947, when we know that they admitted they had a crash craft to the news, then they retracted that comment and said, this is a mistake. It's actually a crash weather balloon. Later on, they said, well, we can prove it. It was a high altitude experiment and the bodies from the crash craft were actually dummies in Operation High Jump. This is all PR. This is all information control. And if you believe for one second that we haven't been trying to shoot them down, the Battle of LA is a very historic event over Los Angeles. A UFO hovered there in the 1940s. We unloaded hundreds of shells at it. And bystanders to this event died because of shells coming down as shrapnel and killing them in their homes. This was a real event that happened. We've been very violent towards our cosmic brothers, and I think crop circles are a way of sending a message to us that circumvents that violent interaction of our militaries trying to make sure that they do not come uninvited and they do not, you know, try to give us information they don't want controlled.
Well, here's where we are, is in my life and my understanding of how the visitors think of us. You say that violence is the right word. We are untamed, dangerous, helpless, desperate, and beautiful. And that's why they're here. That's why they don't come forward, because it's too dangerous.
I would add one more category to that list, Whitley, which is we're hugely self-deceptive, which comes back to your point about why won't some of these old guys say anything, you know, why do they say anything but aliens? Why won't they look at the facts? Why do they insist so much, so doggedly, to stay in the same place where they feel comfortable and their view of the reality in the world is the way that they see it? It's this phenomena of willful blindness that many of us can exhibit and behave in that way, where we won't look at the facts of the situation. We want to fight doggedly and unreasonably to maintain our own position. I think the book that you wrote with Jeffrey Krepow, Supernatural, where you gave a quote towards the end of the book, you said the discovery of the reality behind the UFO and alien apparitions and the discovery of our own truths will prove to be profoundly intertwined. And I think that's why we're getting the contact in the way that we're getting it, to try to make us realize there's deception all around the story, around the crop circles. There's self-deception, and we can't communicate telepathically or in some other way with a race of beings if we're so full of deception that's been put upon us by the media and the governments, and the deception that we put upon ourselves.
Deception, self-deception is the curse of mankind. And as Annie always said, the human species is too young to have beliefs. We need to have good questions. And if you have good questions, you're not going to deceive yourselves. unfortunately, we'd like to go past the questions to the answers before we have them. And then when people disagree with us, we're liable to kill them. We've been doing that through our whole history.
True.
All right. Now, I want to go back to Chilbolton just briefly. And were you by any chance ever there, Gary?
No, I didn't get to that formation, unfortunately. It's not one I walked around.
Well, then let's move on. I want to move on now to the Crabwood Formation. And can one of you describe the formation for our listeners and viewers?
Well, I've just done a piece for this. It's going to be on Mexican TV this Sunday, actually. I've done a whole piece on this particular crop circle, the Crabwood Alien.
Ah, good, good.
The interesting thing is that came, obviously, the next year. And remember I mentioned that the face was using this kind of technique of little circles taken from newspaper print. Well, the Crabwood Alien used the lines that we see in video. They use this technique where we see these interlaced lines of different thicknesses to create the image. And there's three, a lot of people don't notice, there's three flying saucers or UFOs above the shoulder of the alien. And then, there's the disc, which obviously Paul Vigée decoded using the ASCII computer code to change it into the English alphabet. And that's when we got this message. Which I think is even more profound today and even more evident today with the deceptions that we're all noticing with politicians and various other things that are going on in the world. But beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises, much pain but still time, believe there is good out there. This is a very profound message.
We oppose deception.
We oppose deception. And a lot of people don't know that.
Not everybody does.
Well, when Doug and Dave, this is an interesting thing. In 1991, when Doug and Dave came out and made their announcement that they were responsible for the crop circles, there was a very small crop circle, what we called the Milk Hill Script, which was just on the other side of the road from Eastfield, under the White Horse. And it was just some text with two circles at the end of it. Well, Professor Gerald Hawkins enlisted the assistance of a bunch of linguists, and they took several months and went through various languages and eventually found that this script was written in a very obscure form of post-Augustan Latin. And the words were opono astos, which translates as we oppose deception. So coinciding with the big deception that was played on the world, there was this tiny little crop circle over in the corner that said, we oppose this.
And yet here we are. And I had the impression from the message, from the Crabwood message, that there is somebody who has come with gifts and has deceived those they gave the gifts to. Now, I know a lot about these gifts. One of my uncles was actually involved in the first analysis of the Roswell materials at Wright Field in 1947, and the biological materials. And I knew him, of course, he was my uncle, and his commanding officer, General Arthur Exon. My listeners know all about this, but he told me a great deal about what had really happened, and I based my novel Majestic on it. I couldn't do it as fact because I didn't have any documentation. But they would have had no reason to lie to me whatsoever. Could it be that there is more than one approach to us out there? In other words, somebody is deceiving us in some way, maybe that does not have our best interests at heart. And those are the ones that the people who want to make this all into weapons have come into contact with. And there's somebody else out there who I feel like I'm in contact with, because the visitors I know and live with and have had in my life for so long hate deception. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when I was younger, I used to play a lot of practical jokes, and they don't even like that. I would never play a practical joke on them, but they do have senses of humor.
But
there could be different forms, different objectives.
Yeah, I think, I was interviewing Richard Dolan just last week. He just wrote a book called Alien Agendas. And he's a historian, you know, he's a PhD historian who turned his sights to the UFO and the possible extraterrestrial question some years ago. And he's written many books about this. From a historical and factual data point perspective, very, very intelligent man. And he states in his latest book that, you know, there's such a vast number of accounts that seem to prove that there's multiple races interacting with our planet. That means there's multiple agendas. That means there's multiple perspectives of where we could go with our future as mankind. And I think you're exactly right, Whitley, in the fact that you might be interacting with a certain group, you know, that is concerned for our future. And it's perhaps very possible that the military-industrial complex, the United States, many people have, discussed this in length, that there might have been an agreement, there might have been a technology transfer agreement for certain things, and abduction, and you know, the eventual treaty that was signed came into effect where they can do certain things on our planet. And maybe this is another group that has malevolent intentions, you know, that do not have our best interests. They only have their interests in mind. And I hope, you know, that we'll find out more about who are interacting with us for sure as we go down this road of disclosure in whatever form it ends up. But I am skeptical about this version of disclosure that we're getting right now in the public eye, because it is backed predominantly by the military industrial complex. You know, Gary, he'll even discuss many of the events that he's been involved with. For example, 777 that happened July 7, 2007.
Yeah, I was just going to ask about that in a few minutes, but go ahead.
You know, he saw bear witness to a paranormal event. And this was recorded and not reported by the mainstream media in any way. It's only reported by independent researchers like myself, you know, people that are kind of activists in a way that want to get this information out into the public in a bigger way.
Well, I think, Gary, obviously the moment now has come to talk about the 777 experience.
It was, I'd been researching crop circles at that point for 10 years. So from 97 to 2007, I had 10 years. And the man that took me to the crop circles gave me some very good advice and told me to kind of ground myself in all the experiences, because I was having some very profound experiences in the initial days, which were quite difficult to ground. And so he advised me to get those grounded by doing lots of Tai Chi and yoga and meditation and get myself sorted and understand that reality isn't previously what I thought it was. And then to conduct my own research for 10 years, which I did. I didn't join any groups. I didn't really hang around with any of the other people. I just went and did my own thing and read books and studied geometry and so on. I went back to university in 2005 to do a linguistics degree to understand symbols and semiotics and how we can make meaning from things. And I was on a summer break, and so I took my trailer down to Wiltshire. I lived 70 miles away in Cardiff at that point, and was hanging out at the Crop Circle Cafe every day, meeting all the people, having interesting conversations and so on. And because the date of 777 was approaching, it's not night watches are not something I'd ever done. But I thought, oh, well, let's roll the dice, huh? So I decided to go and sit on Knapp Hill, overlooking Eastfield, which is where the first big pictogram crop circle come, the one that was on Led Zeppelin's cover. And my girlfriend came with me. And when we got there, we met up with a cameraman, a UFO researcher, who had seen a ball of light in that field 20 years before, but hadn't managed to catch it on his camera. And so he'd been returning from North Yorkshire every year with more and more sophisticated equipment in the hopes that he could catch some ball of light or UFO. And so there he was with these cameras recording video to his, he had cameras on the front of his van that were recording some video. He'd been recording since 11 o'clock, which is when it's still light in England. So it was clear there was nothing in the field at that time. And he had an image enhancing camera with us on top of the hill and a stills camera he was taking long exposures with. And we sat down, we had a really great conversation. And about 20 past three in the morning, there was a big flash of light. It hadn't been a stormy evening, but it was like you would get from sheet lightning. I remember we were sitting on the grass, and for that flash of light, I could see the grass. So we talked about it for a moment, and I remember saying, you know, if there's something in that field down there, I bet this is when it happened, and kind of half joking. Excuse me. And then about 15 minutes or so after that, Wynne decided to look through the lens, the viewfinder of one of the cameras he had there, and immediately gestured for us to get up. We were wrapped in sleeping bags and blankets and have a look. And so we did. And through the viewfinder, we could see this 1,033-foot crop circle consisting of 150 circles laid out in the darkness in front of us. We couldn't see it with our eyes at that point.
Based on a flash of light.
And so we had to wait another 15 or so minutes, 20 minutes before the light started to come up. And then my girlfriend and I... The sunlight. We jumped in, we walked down to the car park, my girlfriend and I. The cameraman stayed on top of the hill to film us. And we drove to the bottom of Eastfield and walked into the formation. And you see, we're just like little ants in this vast... over 360 meters by 170 meters wide formation. And so, you know, for my own part, I know because I was there, the whole place was electric. We had a headache for a week when we when we walked into it. Every step we took was like static electricity, which Levengood, when he examined the crop, said he had been affected by plasma, and that's why we experienced the static, because the electrons were jumping back into their orbit when we were grounding it.
Tell us a little bit about Dr. Levengood. Either of you who wish to, we haven't mentioned his name yet, and he was an enormously important factor in all of this. Can you tell us a little bit about Dr. Levengood?
Well, so Nancy Talbot, a crop circle researcher, she kind of got the team together with Mr. Burke and Dr. Levengood, and that's why they called it BLT research, for their initials, Burke, Levengood and Talbot. And he was a biophysicist, and he took an interest. He told Nancy how to gather samples of soil and crop in a scientifically safe way, and gather control samples and package them up and send them to his laboratory. And he examined the wheat and the crops from many crop circles and the soil. I think one of the most profound things that came out of his research is, he first of all established that that there's evidence that the crop is affected by electricity and microwaves, and that the soil is affected by magnetism. And the evidence for that was the blown nodes. So if you put a piece of crop in a microwave and heat it up, the moisture blows it.
When you say blown nodes, what do you mean?
So when you look at a piece of wheat, you will have a stem, and then there will be like a kneecap, like a joint. And then the stem will go on for another 10 or so inches, and there'll be another knuckle or a joint. And those nodes, they're typically more solid and robust than the stem of the crop itself, which is actually easy to bend and break. And what we found in crop circles is that these nodes have little pit holes in them. We call it expulsion cavities, which is caused by the moisture inside the crop being heated up and needing somewhere to escape. That's its escape route. It blows holes in these nodes to let them out, which has been
written. I've seen blown nodes with my own eyes, by the way, folks.
Yeah, me too.
Formations. He's talking about something entirely real. Now, in your documentary, in the Jaime Masson discusses particles of, is it magnetite in the formations?
It's iron.
Iron, yeah, bits of iron. Well, you know, I back in the 90s, I ended up examining a formation in Texas, of all places. It wasn't worth. It was not. It was in a cattle feedlot, which I don't know if you've ever been anywhere near a cattle feedlot, but it wasn't pretty. It wasn't. I don't think. But the rancher, called MUFON, and. The director of MUFON at the time wanted nothing to do with this. So he sent me an email, and I, of course, did want to do something with it. And I gathered a group of investigators from Southwest Research Institute in Texas and the Mind Science Foundation, which is no longer doing this sort of thing, but in those days was very actively involved in the EDGE, the Texas Mind Science Foundation. Both of them were founded by dear friend of my family, and so you know there's a lot of personal association there too. So we went out to this formation, and we had magnetometers, we had cameras, we had video cameras, we had one of those things that searches for metal. And the formation itself, I got into the formation and started searching for metal, and we got samples, and we later found the same thing you're talking about, Gary, in this little formation was all of this metal, all this iron, little bits of iron. But two things that were really weird. The first one is the rancher noticed it because all of the cattle in the feedlot would surround it in a circle and put their noses in it, and they couldn't be pushed away. If you pushed them away, they went back again. He wanted to feed those cattle and fatten them up for sale, and he was having a lot of trouble with them. When I was working in the formation with the device that detected the iron moving through the formation, I was suddenly struck by a tremendous my energy, body energy, was just absorbed. I could barely walk back to the car. I slept for 24 hours.
I've had that. We call it zaps.
So you're sort of nodding your head. Tell us a little bit. I want to hear your response to this story.
Well, so I've got one story I could remember. I mentioned it the other day in an interview. My girlfriend and I were on our way to Avebury for the summer solstice celebrations, probably about 8 o'clock at night. We were driving down the A361 towards Avebury, and my girlfriend noticed a crop circle in the field at Beckhampton. Said, is that new formation? Do we know anything about a crop circle there? And I said, no, I don't think so. Let's investigate. So we pulled the car over, went inside. It was a beautiful formation in barley. We walked around inside, took some pictures, which didn't come out. For some reason, the camera didn't work on my phone for that inside the crop circle, which is obviously something else that's happened many times to people. And then we came out, and our full intention was to stay up all night at the Avebury solstice celebrations, but we couldn't. We just felt completely drained. We had to get in the car, barely made it home, and slept for 12 hours.
That energy is there then. I'm not the only one who has that experience, I'm happy to say.
I've been a tour guide for a number of years. I've taken lots and lots of people to crop circles, and it gave me the unique opportunity to watch and observe people's reactions when they walked inside crop circles. And there is no doubt that you have people who cry, people who laugh and become high, too much energy, or people who get drained, or people who become very pensive. There's this broad range of emotional responses to entering a crop circle.
Oh, Darcy, you look like you're ready to say something here.
Well, I'll just add that it's obvious that something's going on energy-wise in these formations that's not normal. People feel it, you know, and you see it. You see that, you know, if Doug and Dave were creating these, you would see clear evidence, and Gary has seen it himself, of the crop being broken, whether that's canola, barley, flaxseed, corn, wheat. You would see it crunched down. And when that happens, right, the plants can't keep growing. The plants are dying. And when he goes into these ones that are incredibly complex, they're geometric, they're 3D, they're made in all different types of crop as a medium to play with, and they're made on hills, uneven ground, but they're symmetrical, you know. And when you see this, when he sees this himself, he'll see that the plant, it may have those expulsion cavities, right? The nose, it almost looks like the plant has been wheeled down, you know, the plant has leaned down, it's been steamed down or something by some kind of electromagnetic force. And the plants are woven. That's how the formation stays down. It's not that they're just crushed down. There is a lattice of support, of structure that's keeping it down. And as the sun comes up, and if people don't en masse come to these formations and stomp all over them because they want to walk through them and experience them first person, what Gary has noticed is the plants are still thriving. If this was Doug and Dave or some other hoaxers that had created these incredibly complex formations in a really short amount of time, they would have died and the plants wouldn't be subject to what he says is phototropism. You know, this is where through photosynthesis, the sun starts hitting the plant and it starts to rise towards the sun. It's trying to go towards the sun. You can see that with your flowers or plants in your house. If you put it by a window, the stalk will start morphing and it'll be going towards the sun. So all the petals can start to soak up more sun. They're like, ooh, sun, I love this, right? Well, the plants in the crops are doing the same thing. They're actually still alive. And the crop farmers are usually still able to yield something from these crops. Yes, exactly. So that's another interesting point. The other interesting point that I'll leave you with is the fact that, you know, we've seen orbs, you know, this has been reported, balls of fire in 1678. And the gentleman who was filming the flash, and when the East Field orbs, or sorry, the East Field formation that Gary saw in 777, this gentleman had tried for 20 years. He had come back to these fields to try and record orbs that he had seen flying over these formations. And in the documentary, we show this famous video, which is called the Oliver Castle event. I think that is it, right, Gary?
Yes, and they've been desperate attempts to debunk it, but we have reached the end of the first hour, which means that before we explain the truth about that video, which is extraordinary, I want to let the Free Dreamlanders know that don't believe the debunking of that video. Or any of these things. This is real, and we've discussed earlier why it is so important. Reconnect with the crop formations. That's why we're doing this season, this year on Dreamland. We're right at the beginning of the crop circle season. It's going to be a big ho-hum again, and that must not be. Someone is here. They have chosen this method as one of the methods of communicating with us. This is very precious. It is so precious that it is sacred to us and sacred to them. We have to respect that. And we have to face the fact that the material culture that we have built, the soulless, empty culture that makes us so lonely and fills us with an addiction for material goods, is failing because it was never meant to do anything else. There is another world waiting, and you can sense that message in the crop formations if you open your mind and heart to them. Crop Circle Realities is a beautifully made, highly intelligent film about the crop circles. I assure you, you will not be able to stop watching it. And Darcy, incidentally, has done incredibly cool film we haven't discussed, but we'll have to have him on back to discuss it, called Underground Basis. And then there's another one called Being Taken, which is about our stuff. So this is a very important filmmaker. He calls himself an activist. Well, I think that's the right word for you. And Gary is a dedicated researcher, highly knowledgeable. These are two phenomenal experts, and I want to thank you on behalf of the Free Dreamlanders for spending some time with us. And they're going to spend another half hour with us talking about absolutely critical things. We're going to get into those lights that move through the formations at Oliver's Castle, and what they may mean. So thank you, and Free Dreamlanders, bye-bye. Subscribers will keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.